गुड मॉर्निंग सर।
गुड मॉर्निंग। कैन एवरीबडी कम इन द वीडियो मोड। Monali, Ashwini, Rashmi, Tejaswini, Rohin, can you please come in the video mode?
Yes, sir.
Any more students joining, or this is the strength in the morning? Akhila, not well or still sleeping?
No, sir, I'm not well.
Okay, okay, okay. Okay, we'll wait for another 2 minutes and then we'll get started. Okay, in the meanwhile, Rashmi, we'll start with your discussion first. Are you there, Rashmi?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, because you are waiting for this discussion for a long time. Okay.
Yes, sir.
If you understand the practical components, okay, first one is to solve a case study on workplace ethics, discussions on how to evaluate the performance of MBA students. Now, this was one thing that I had already told you. How do we evaluate the performance of MBA student? And we have discussed it in the class also. Like on what basis evaluate the performance. Okay, that is done. Then visit our organization and find out the problems and causes for unethical behavior at workplace. Now, this you cannot do because you cannot visit an organization. But definitely, you can just pull out some case studies from the internet for unethical behavior. Okay, and try to analyze it and write it. Am I clear on that? Okay, instead of, you cannot visit an organization in this particular situation. So you can just pull out some, there are lots of case studies available on the internet on unethical behavior. Okay, so you have to just pull out those cases and then find out the problems and causes for unethical behavior.
So like how many case studies?
Just one.
Minimum.
Just one.
Yes.
Just one case of one company where there was unethical behavior which was found. So you have to find out that problem, what was the real problem and what were the causes and what is the probable solution, if you can give any probable solution to it.
Yes, sir.
Okay, So you can take an example of PNB also, the scam that happened in PNB, the manager who was involved into that particular scam, that is unethical behavior. Okay, so what led to that problem? What was the real cause of that problem? What led to the problem and what is the probable solution? That can be an example for it. Okay, I'm just giving you an example. You need not take PNB at all. Okay, you can take any such cases where unethical behaviors are found. You can just type in Google cases on unethical behavior or case studies on unethical behavior. You'll get lots of case studies.
Yes.
Is it clear? Okay. So next one was identify the important HR metrics using the companies. This is what we have already done.
Yes, sir. Okay,
we have discussed it also. Okay. Then next one is ask students to collect manpower data of your institution and prepare HR dashboard. Okay. So this was a problem, like you don't know how to prepare a dashboard, first of all. Okay. So what we'll do is, okay, because dashboard, to teach you dashboard, we have to understand Excel. Okay. We have to do it in Excel itself. Fine. So in one of the classes, maybe in the next week or after your second IIT test, I'll take a class exclusively only to study dashboards, how to prepare dashboards. Okay.
Yes.
Have a rough data of some human resource, and then we can have a dashboard. How to prepare a dashboard, a performance dashboard. Okay, so I'll help you to understand how to prepare a performance dashboard. The same thing, you can do it in your assignments. Okay, you have to prepare a performance dashboard. And the last one is collect the payroll details of from IT company and use module 6 contents. Okay, so again. Sorry, was that from my end, that sound?
No sound.
Okay, fine. Okay, so basically the last practical component also you cannot do it right now, okay, because it covers the unit number 6. Okay, so just hold on to that particular thing. Fine. What we'll do is, okay, I'll just postpone the dates of your practical component submission for HR analytics. Okay, and these two things I'll just teach you, and then you can submit me the entire thing, the entire practical component at once. Is it okay to everyone?
So already we have written those first and third question in the assignment. No need to write again in practical components.
No, it in the assignment. That was a different issue. That was a different case. Now you have to write it as a practical component again, Ashwini.
Okay, sir.
Okay, that was an assignment that was just random, which was given to you. That is not a part of your practical component. Now these go. This goes as valuation. Understand? Practical component goes as valuation. So you have to have it as practical component itself.
Okay.
So maybe whatever you have written, the same thing, you can just take a picture and put it as a practical component now. You may not have to write it again. Understanding?
Yeah. I understood.
Okay, anyways, you have to submit the soft copy itself, right?
Yes.
Okay, so you can take a picture,
scan
the same assignment what you have written as a practical component, and then
practical component.
This file. Of practical component. I hope that solves your doubts, Rashmi.
Yes, sir.
Not Rashmi as such, but everybody had the same doubts, I guess, right, Mulunali?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so I hope that is clear. So maybe in the next week I'll try to take a small class on how to prepare dashboards. Accordingly, you have to assume data and prepare a dashboard of your own. Okay, and then the last unit, I'll just check if we can do the last unit now and then complete the practical component, or you have to submit only the first four practical components, leave the last one. Okay, that I'll check and that I'll see and let you know. Okay, but right now don't hurry up to submit your practical component, HR analytics practical component. Do not hurry up to submit. Okay, I'll give you time to submit HR analytics practical component.
Okay, sir.
Okay, yes, so we'll start with the class now. Okay, just give me a second. I'll just share the screen. Okay, there are only 17 of you all present. Okay, doesn't matter. Okay, just confirm if you can see the screen. Is the screen visible?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Sorry. Yeah. So in the previous class, if you remember, we had started with something called as predictive analysis, which helps you in predicting the future. Okay. So we have completed most of the parts. Just a minute. What is happening here? Yes. So we have done this predictive analysis cycle. We know what is predictive analysis. We studied this cycle. Then we went on to how it is applied in various industries like banking, oil and gas, health, retail, government, and manufacturing. Then we tried to understand what are the advantages of predictive analysis, like how it is useful in detecting frauds, okay, optimizing marketing campaign, then improving the operations and reducing your risk. So these are the advantages. And then I guess we had started with this, right? Steps involved in predictive analysis. Then, we completed this.
Completed, sir.
No, I don't think we have completed this. I was at relationship. I remember. Because there are lots of things that we need to. Okay, fine. Whatever it is, I'll just try to explain it once again. Even if you have completed, let's go into details of this. Okay. So, basically, when we talk about predictive analysis, we know that it is predicting the future. We want to know what would happen in future and we want to be prepared for that. Okay, so what do? First, we determine what are the KPIs. Now, what are KPIs, guys? I've already explained what are KPIs. What are KPI?
Key performance indicators.
Key performance indicators. Very nice, right? It's key performance indicators. So first, we need to know what we need to predict. We need to predict the key performance indicators, right? So we need to know what would happen to those indicators which are important to us in future. So first we need to identify what are the key performance indicators, what will determine my performance. That is the first thing. Those KPIs should be communicated to all the parties because it's really important for all the people in the organization to know what are they expected to do? What are they going to be judged upon? Okay, so it is to be properly communicated to all the parties or all the employees or the stakeholders in a particular organization. Then formatting the data for analysis. Yes, whenever you get data is in the raw form. Okay, it doesn't have any proper format. You just get a raw data from maybe internet, from your records, etc. Okay. Now, when you want to go for an analysis, first you need to format the data. You need to put it into a proper format, okay, as per your requirements. Okay, some fields which are not required, you have to delete it. Some fields which are required, you have to add it, okay. Some fields you want it at the last, put it at the last. Some fields you want it at the first, put it in the first column, okay. So that is how you format your data because your analysis is going to speak something. And if your data is not formatted, then your analysis will not be correct. For example, I'll just give you a simple example. If you want to do correlation, okay? Now, when you do correlation, normally there should the data which are there or the columns, let's say dependent and independent variable, they should be simultaneous or they should be one after the other, then only that correlation is possible. Okay, if you have one the independent variable in the first column and the dependent variable in the eighth column, and there are various other columns in between, and you want to find out the correlation, it becomes difficult, or the system starts giving you errors. Okay, so that is the reason why formatting of data is very important when you go for analysis. Okay, any kind of analysis, let it be predictive analysis or any other kind of analysis. Okay, first thing that comes is collecting the data and formatting the data. You need to format it. Okay, next one is analyze and report the data. Yes, once you have formatted the data properly, now you go for analysis. Now analysis can be, as I said, it can be descriptive analysis where you use let's say mean, median, mode, a standard deviation. These are measures of descriptive analysis. Okay, they tell you what is really happening in that particular organization in terms of human resource. Okay, what is the average workload, let's say. Okay, then what is the average time to complete a particular task? What is the average time spent in canteen? What is the average time spent on job? Okay, so when you talk about all these things, you're talking about descriptive analysis. You're just telling what is the real situation, what is the situation in a particular organization. Then you talk about inferential statistics. Now inferential statistics talks about correlation, regression, your ANOVA, etc. Okay, now correlation basically talks about the relationship between the two variables, like one increases, what will happen to another, one decreases, what will happen to the another. That is correlation. Whereas regression talks about strength of association. Okay, how strongly is one variable related to another? Like one increases by one, what would happen to the other? So it talks about a strength of association or strength of relationship between one variable and another variable. Okay, so that is regression. Whereas ANOVA talks about variance. Okay, variance is analysis of variance. Like if independent variable varies, whether it will have any effect on the dependent variable, how much will be the dependent variable vary, okay, and in what proportion, whether it would vary positively, negatively, and how much will it vary. That is what variance, analysis of variance talks about. Okay, so that comes under your inferential statistics. Okay, for example, let's take a simple example. Training, okay, you have to answer me this question. Okay, training and performance. Okay, now I want to do let's say regression. Okay, I'm doing a regression analysis on training and performance. Now what am I expected to get? What results am I expected to get when I'm doing an analysis on the two set of data? One is the training data, another is the performance data, and I am doing a regression analysis. Now, when I'm doing a regression analysis, what is the output that I'm expecting? Can somebody tell me?
So it can help us to know as to what level of training can provide us the what level of performance, sir.
Okay.
What can be the level of performance based on the training?
Okay, okay. But that you don't get using a correlation. You need to go for a regression for that.
So because here we have to predict, right, sir? Because correct. Regression, in regression, taking one variable as the basis, we predict the another variable for future, sir.
Okay. Okay. Yes.
So we can predict using regression.
You're right. When we talk about regression analysis, we are trying to talk about predictions here. Okay, regression helps you to understand the strength of association. Okay, now when I say strength of association, that means one variable is affecting another variable by a particular weight. Okay, like let's say let me take this. Sorry, what happened? Okay, just give me a second. Yeah. Okay. So if I say, a simple equation like y is equal to na plus bx, okay? This is your equation, okay, sorry. I'll take more simpler equation. Okay, yes. Okay, so let's say that demand, okay, there's one. Okay, please excuse me for all these things. Okay, so let's say there is something called as a price. Okay, price is a variable which we have, which depends on, let's say, demand. Okay, which depends on demand as well as plus supply. Okay, so there are two variables which determine price. That is demand and supply. Okay, now let's say that we have found out that the price is 0.48 dependent on demand, plus it is 0.32 on supply. Fine, and the remaining is your constant. Let's say it comes to 0.2. Okay, remaining is 0.2. Fine. So what happens over here is, understand? Okay, if I want to know the price, okay, I need to know the demand. I need to know the supply. Okay, I need to know these two variables, and then I can predict what would be the price. Now, let's say the demand, let's write it over here, okay, demand, okay, supply, and price. These are the three variables, let's say. Okay, demand is 10, supply is 8, okay, price is 20. Demand is, guys, is the screen visible?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
I hope you're able to see it.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, okay, because there's some problem here. Fine. Okay, so next one is, let's say, where did the cursor go? Okay. Yeah, so next one is, let's say, demand is, 20. Okay, supply is also 20. The price is 15, okay? And another is demand is 15, okay? Supply is 17, and the price is 12, okay? Now, if this is the situation, okay? Then, first, what do we do is, we try to find out the regression, we try to do the regression analysis between demand plus supply is equal to price. So these two become your dependent variable, independent variable, whereas price becomes your dependent variable. And let's assume that from this particular data, okay, we have got this equation, okay, like 0.48D plus 0.32S plus 0.2, okay. So now let's assume that the next demand would be 18 and supply would be, let's say, 16. So at this demand and supply, what would be the price? Okay, so how do you do it? It is 0.48 into whatever is the demand, that is 18, plus 0.32 into whatever is the supply, that is 6, plus the constant, that is 0.2. Okay, if you solve this particular equation, let's say 0.48 into 18, can somebody help me out in doing this? I do not have a calculator right now. So can somebody tell me what is 0.48 into 18? Anyone?
So 8.64.
It is?
8.64.
Just a minute. Huh? I'll just erase this off and I'll write it there. Okay. Yeah. Okay. So... okay, so it is 8.64, right? Plus, now, can somebody tell me 16 into 32.32?
So 5.12.
It is? 8 point?
So 5.12.
Sorry, 5 point you said. Okay, sorry. Okay, so it is 5.12. Plus 0.2. So can somebody tell me the answer here?
Sorry.
come to
13.96.
Okay. So maybe if this is the demand, that is 18 is the demand for a particular product, supply is 16, then your price might be 13.96. That is how you determine the price of a particular product. So this is what predictive analysis is. This is how you have done regression. This is what inferential statistics talks about. Okay, using regression analysis, you have tried to find out or you're trying to predict what would be the price of a particular product if demand and supply are so and so. Okay, are you all clear with this now? Guys, understanding?
Yes, sir.
Yes. Okay, so let's go ahead with the next one, that is relationship optimization and predictive analysis. Okay, now relationship, again, when we talk about relationship here, we are talking about predictive analysis itself. Okay, no, sorry, not predictive analysis, sorry, correlation itself. Okay, so relationship, how much are they related to each other? Like in correlation, we have something called as positive correlation, negative correlation, zero correlation. Then we have something called as perfectly positive correlation and perfectly negative correlation. I hope you have studied this. Guys, have you all studied this?
Yes, sir.
Yes. Okay, so can somebody tell me what is a perfect positive correlation? Perfect positive correlation.
So it means that they are very highly correlated, sir.
Okay, can you the extent to which they are for perfect positive correlation?
So one.
Yes, it is positive one, right? So if you yes, say sir. That if the answer of your correlation analysis is one, exactly one, then you say that those two variables are perfectly positively correlated. Okay, then what is the value for a negative correlation? Perfectly negative correlation?
It's minus one.
It's minus one, right? Okay. Then what is positive correlation then? It's not perfectly positive, but
minus one. Correlation. So value between zero and one.
Yes. And negative correlation?
So between zero and minus one.
Very nice. Okay. And what is no correlation? Zero correlation?
Zero, sir.
Very nice.
It's okay. Zero, sir.
So that is what relationship is all about, right? You talk about relationship. Okay, so correlation helps you in understanding how are the variables related to each other. So a part of inferential statistics itself. Okay, optimization basically talks about, okay, how much each and every variable is affecting each other. And on the basis of that, to which variable we have to give more importance. Okay, for example, performance. Now performance, let's say there are two parameters. Okay, one is training and one is on-job training, off-the-job training. Okay, there are two types of training which can be provided. Now when you find out that on-the-job training is more effective than off-the-job training, okay, then classroom training, then what do you do is, okay, you try to give more weightage or more preference to on-the-job training. Okay, that is how you optimize. Okay, that is how you optimize and get the results. Okay, so you know that performance is good when more on-the-job training is provided rather than a classroom training. Okay, so what do you do as an HR manager, as a training manager? What do you do is you plan the training as per this prediction and plan more on-job trainings rather than the off-the-job training or classroom trainings. Okay, then last one is the predictive analysis. Okay, as I said, regression is the best method used for predictive analysis. Okay, most of us use regression analysis itself to do the predictive analysis, but there is another method, okay, which I'll be dealing in the next slide. Okay, that I'll tell you what is the method about. Okay, so regression plus is one more method that I'll tell you. Okay, next one is interpreting the results. Okay, once you get the results of your analysis, whether it is correlation, regression, ANOVA, or any other techniques or tools that you have used, and you have got a results, Now you have to interpret them, trying to find out what is important, what is not important, what is really having an impact, what is not having an impact. And accordingly, you have to take your judgments. Accordingly, you have to take your decisions. Okay. And based on the results, you try to predict the future. Okay. Ultimately, that is what is all about. Okay. So that I'll be dealing in the next slides. Okay. Now, as I said, in the next slide, there is something that I'm going to deal is, okay, that is this. Can somebody tell me what this might be? Any idea? Okay, it's a technical rangoli, guys. Okay, since it's Diwali time, and I thought I'll show you a different way to draw a rangoli. You can try this rangoli at home. Okay, basically this is called as structural equation modeling. Okay, SEM, structural equation modeling. Okay, now what is the structural equation modeling is? If you see, there is something called as a region. Okay, I have just pulled it out from one of the analysis that I had done. Okay, so this is region. Okay, from which region you belong to. Okay, and these are some, these are called as biases. Okay, the biases that every individual has. Okay, so these are the biases, and these are the, let's say, the variables that determine your portfolio. More towards finance, because I have done this in finance, so I'm just giving you this example, but that will make you understand what is structural equation modeling. Okay, now what I was trying to find out here is, using the structural equation modeling, is how is region affecting the behavior. Now these are the behavioral biases, so this determine the behavior of an individual. Okay, so how is this region, like people from north, people from south, people from east, west, etc., how are they, okay, behaving? How do they behave? What is the effect of this region on the behavior? Okay, are there any common patterns, like people from north, how are they in terms of overconfidence, representativeness, anchoring, etc.? Okay, so how do region affect the behavior, and in turn, how do these two things affect the portfolio choice of a particular investor? That is what I was trying to find out using this structural equation modeling. Okay, like see here, this is an independent variable. Okay, now these are the dependent variables, which are dependent on region, plus this is a dependent variable which is dependent on these two. So this becomes an independent variable again. So it is structural equation. Okay, there is no fixed dependent and fixed independent variable. Your dependent independent variable keep on changing as per the need. Okay, so these are this overconfidence, representativeness, anchoring, these are sometimes dependent variable which are dependent on region, but again they become independent variable which determine what would be the portfolio choice. Okay, so trying to find out the relationship, if you see the arrows there, region to all the behavioral biases, region to direct portfolio, then overconfidence to all the variables of portfolio, representativeness to all the variables of portfolio, etc. So this is how an structural equation modeling is built. Okay, so there are lots of variables which are considered, and trying to find out the relationship between direct relation and indirect relationship between one variable and another variable, and then trying to predict how much are they related to each other. Again, we come back to regression only, but this is a way to do the structural equation modeling. Okay, so that is what is structural equation modeling, another way of predicting your predictive analysis, or predicting the future. What would be the portfolio if he's from north and he has these characteristics, then what would be the choice of his portfolio? That is what is structural equation modeling. Okay, a bit complex to understand, I know that. Okay, but try to understand this, that in structural equation modeling, you try to create a direct and indirect relationship between variables to find out how are they related to each other, or how much impact does one variable has on another variable, whether it is a direct impact or indirect impact. Now this cannot be done using regression. Okay, regression gives you the direct impact, but indirect impact is given by the structural equation modeling. Okay, so that is another way of predictive analysis. Okay, so in predictive analysis, we can use regression as well as we can use the structural equation modeling. Okay, next one is the HR analytics tool. Okay, we are almost at the end of this particular module. Okay, now HR analytics tools, basically the only tool that most of the tools that we use is Matrix. Okay, now what is Matrix? It's a measure of quantitative assessment. Okay, it measures the quantitative measures the performance of various variables quantitatively. Okay, it gives you a quantitative assessment and it is used for assessing, comparing and tracking performance. Okay, so where do we use Matrix? We use it for assessing the performance, comparing the performance, as well as tracking the performance, the future performance, whether you're going as per the set standards or no. That is where you use the Matrix. Okay, now next one is let's say types of matrix. So we have something called as efficiency matrix, we have something called as effectiveness matrix, and we have impact matrix. Now can somebody tell me what is efficiency, impact, efficiency, then effectiveness and impact? Anyone? Quickly, we are running out of time. So can somebody tell me this? What may be this effectiveness, efficiency matrix? What may be this effectiveness matrix?
So is it a type of post matrix, pre matrix, post matrix, and after matrix?
No.
Wherein efficiency is how the.
So last time you told that
And effectiveness is how much they perform, and impact is the result, the final result of the employees.
Okay. Yes, to some extent, you're right. Okay. Rohan, yes, you were saying something? I guess it was Rohan only who spoke in between.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Sir, last time you said effective means it's... Yes, sir.
Go ahead. Rohan, please go ahead.
Sir?
Yes, please go ahead.
Sir, effective is about doing the right things.
Okay.
Sir, effective means you're doing the right things, whereas efficient is about doing things right.
Efficiency, yes, you're right. But we are talking about what is efficiency matrix and what is effectiveness matrix. So efficiency matrix is basically trying to understand the performance of a HR department, let's say. Okay, and effectiveness is measure the effect of HR programs. Okay, that is where you talk about effectiveness. Efficiency is how are you performing? How is your performance? That is efficiency matrix. Okay, effectiveness matrix is effect of one on another. Impact matrix also is almost the same. Okay, impact of one particular decision on another decision. So both of these are trying to find out a relationship between two variables where you're trying to find out whether that decision was effective or no. Okay, or whether that decision had an impact on that particular desired variable or no. That is what these metrics talks about. So efficiency only speaks about performance. How was your performance? Okay, effectiveness talks about what was the effect of one variable on another variable, one decision on the desired measure. Okay, and impact also again talks about what impact did this particular decision had on the desired variable. Okay, so these are the three metrics that normally are used in HR analytics. Okay, so these are some of the examples of metrics used, like monthly turnover rate.